time for the John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show on the Columbus River Dragons Radio Network. Tonight's show is brought to you by John Emerald Distilling, Southern States Bank, BioLife Plasma, Midas Total Car Care, Vector Ply, and PMB Broadcasting. Now to catch you up on all things River Dragons hockey, let's start tonight's show with Zach DeBozart.
Thank you very much, Brian Thomas, and welcome in to another edition of the John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show. It's a Tuesday night, 6 o'clock. I'm Zach DeBozart, the head coach as always. Jerome Bichard is here. Jerome?
Zach.
And we've got our special player guest, one of the newest River Dragons to the squad, number 4, Alex Storjohann. Alex, how are we doing?
Good, Zach. How are you doing?
Doing great. It's going to be a fun show. Very interesting weekend. It was
glad you didn't butcher that name like I've been butchering it for.
You know what?
Not about 6 nicknames this weekend.
Nobody go back and listen to Friday's game because there was at least 3 or 4 different unique pronunciations, I'm sure. I'm thankful, though, that you scored in your second game because by that time I had figured it out.
Yeah, that was a great call.
Thank you. So we got it figured out by there. But an interesting weekend for sure. Whiteout weekend theme all weekend long. The whiteout jerseys. A lot of positive, a few people, not the hugest of fans, but ultimately very successful auction, very successful weekend. Guys had some fun. What was your assessment overall, Jerome?
I thought it was a great weekend of hockey in Columbus. Unfortunately, you know, we only took one out of the 3 games, but you know, I thought it was a great weekend all in all.
I mean, you look at it, it was going to be number 1 versus number 2. You knew they were going to be competitive, and I talked about it on one of the broadcasts using Watertown's games, the games against Watertown, as a measuring stick. You can really just see how much this team has grown from the 2 games we played in Watertown back in, what, November to now here in late March, how much better this team has gotten.
Yeah, well, it's a different, totally different team. When we went up there, we're shorthanded and this and that, hadn't played together and all that stuff. So, and then you throw in the travel and up there, whatever, and all that stuff. But yeah. No, it was definitely a great measuring stick, and I mean, that's the best that they can play, which I'm thinking they're not missing anybody in this and that, and considering the fact that we had, you know, pretty much 3 new players in the lineup, maybe even 4 if you count Schulze, doesn't play a whole lot type thing, and then you throw in the fact that we didn't skate all week, really. 2 practices over in Birmingham on Tuesday, Wednesday, so having 12 days off in between games, I kind of knew we were going to come out probably sluggish, which we didn't.
Yeah, that was the weird part.
Which we didn't, but you know, the wheels, I don't want to say the wheels, but we didn't have our legs, we didn't have our jump, our timing was terrible and all that stuff, so every game it got better and better, and you know, by Sunday, and be honest with you, by Sunday I thought it was a good hockey game.
Yeah, it definitely was. I mean, let's jump right into it. We mentioned the start. The first game, it really felt like the first 3 minutes and then the next 57 minutes. Austin Doe, 2 straight goals, 1:15 mark, a power play, a setup from Petrantonio and Vanelli, and then 3 minutes into the first, Petrantonio again, centers one for Doe, easy tap in for him right there. Jagger Williamson also picked up a secondary assist on that. 2 goals, 3 minutes in against the number 1 team in the league after everything you had talked about, the days off, the minimal ice, the traveling to other cities and states for practice. I mean, that had to be a dream start.
Yeah, no, I was pretty excited, and the bench was pretty excited, and I'm like, in the back of my head, I'm easy, boys, just settle down, just, you know, we got a little too exuberant, and then kind of, you know what, I think Watertown got their legs a little bit underneath them, and you know what, they play a style that go, and we're kind of a possession hockey team, but in a different way, and so is Watertown, but they're a possession team more the fact that they like to throw the puck quick, and you know, with all the stuff that we said prior to why we play bad, We were holding on the puck and trying to make a perfect play and waiting for that pass to open up, as opposed to really just moving the puck and letting our guys skate into things. And, you know, again, our timing was off. Ice was bad. All the above. It wasn't conducive for how we were going
to
play.
Still took a little bit for Watertown to get on the board, which, you know, when you see kind of what you were leading into, you know, settle down, let's get everything, you know, still figured out. Seemed like the team was doing that, but then 13:52 mark of the second, Cole McKechnie finds the top right corner, ended up being a delayed penalty on the play, but it wasn't a 6-on-5 at that opportunity because it was bang, bang. But that goal made it 2-1. To me, I would have thought, yes, you had the hot start, simmered off a little bit, but the fact that it took Watertown more than half a game to score probably had some positives to it, no?
Yeah, and you know what? Yeah, like, I mean, as bad as we were playing and as bad as we played like Friday night, we were in the game, and you know, that's all a positive to take out of it. I mean, and quite frankly, I don't want to blame the refs, but the refs had had some very... two bad missed calls that had an implication on them scoring their first and second goals. So I think the one that hurt us the most was the second goal with 30 seconds left to go in the second off the faceoff. And again, that was a miss center on center. I think Huntsie lost a draw and he kind of loses his centerman, and you know, McDonald's just an old kind of crafty guy, and he just kind of sits there and, you know, kind of a tap in deflection kind of thing on the second goal. And I'd like to say that was probably the game. We didn't really have a whole lot of push after that. And but, you know, entertaining, it was good, and this and that. And, you know, we gave ourselves a chance. We didn't have a whole lot of good looks. Our power play, again, was sluggish. We didn't get a chance to really work on that. And then you throw guys in there. Don't know if I had the right line combination on Friday, which I know I didn't, but tried to see if that would work, if it would work, and it didn't. So changed things up for Saturday.
Yeah, that Justin McDonald goal was a killer. Less than 30 seconds in the period. We obviously talked to death. First minute, last minute, it just seems like a little extra momentum boost, and it definitely helped Watertown.
Yeah, and we've given up a few of those, and we got to stop. And you know, at that point, you know, we're at a point of the season where, with the lineup, I mean, all three lines. I mean, I was trying to match a little bit, but for the most part, with us not skating for those 2 weeks and not being in great shape or what our game shape. Trying to keep shift short and really kind of tough to match lines, and we really weren't. And be honest with you, we have, in my opinion, three number one lines, and I say that I have three lines. Maybe one of those lines may not be as potent offensively, but as far as defensively, I mean, that could be a shutdown line with anybody.
Friday's game finished out 4-2. That Justin McDonald goal, 30 seconds left in the second, tied the game. Then Alexander Jemayev, a power play tally. McDonald was his second of the game on an empty netter. Justin McDonald is on absurd pace, 57 goals after this weekend, leads the FPHL.
How many points did he have against us this weekend?
He had two there, 3 points. So, but two of them were done in that Friday game for damage.
So, what's his point per game average?
Point per game, we're looking at 112 points for him. And he's not played in every Watertown game, I know that much. So that points per game number is going to go up a little bit once it tells me the number. Well, it's trying to calculate it, but
I guess
there it is. 2.5.
So, 2.5. So, yeah. I think you...
his per game he got in a weekend.
For that, I mean, I'd like to think he's playing against teams that can't play against him, and we can. So, you know, I thought, you know, with all that said, I thought, it was a good weekend.
Yes. Saturday, moving into that game, we get a milestone in this. Alex Storjohann picks up his first career pro goal before we break into the game. Alex, how good did that one feel?
Felt good. You know, I just came in this weekend, wanted to play my game, didn't know how it fit in, and you know, luckily got a nice break and found the back of the net.
Take us through the play. What were you seeing? You had a clean shot, pretty clean look at it, right?
Yeah, so, you know, our game plan, we were trying to get in on the forecheck, play pretty hard, and puck came up the wall. Ozo made a great play on his guy. I found the loose puck, and, you know, luckily the goalie kind of whiffed on it.
At that point, that was bringing the game back to 2-1, and all goals were in the second period to that point. Alexander Jemayev and Kyle Heitzner made it 2-0, and then Storjohann, first career and first for the River Dragons at the 15-12 mark. Probably a good shot in the arm heading in there, and third period, just couldn't find that goal late, could we?
Yeah, again, we played better Friday night than we did on Saturday, but we're still lacking some jump and push and all that stuff, and I know I changed the lines again a little bit, so, you know, trying to get, you know, everyone's, you know, little what's the word I'm looking for, Zach?
Tendencies?
Yeah, that's a good word. That's, yeah, that's what I was
there
looking
for.
There
we go. For. I'm the word guy. That's, I should know that.
You know, just trying to get, you know, get the tendencies with what's going on, and you know, just wasn't happening. And again, power play wasn't great. Our penalty kill was pretty good, but again, we, you know, when we get some opportunities on the power play, we're gonna bury them.
That game finished 3-1. Alexander Jemayev had an empty netter. Two straight games with empty netters. I mean, you look, all right, two goal loss, but I mean, the empty netter just sort of throws that out of whack. It doesn't show how competitive really both those two games were, even though Columbus came on the wrong side of both of them.
Yeah, and again, you go through, pull the goalie. I think it was Vanelli kind of coughed the puck up to cause that or whatever. And again, it goes back to, you know, what I said earlier, we're just always trying to make that perfect play and that perfect pass to put somebody in. And you know what? Sometimes we have to learn as a team, hey, got to do what it works. It works for everybody else. Dump the puck in and go get it and go outwork somebody. And again, and Watertown's defensemen are all pretty good. They're all pretty big. They're all pretty good. Big. If you give them time, they can move the puck. And, you know, for the better part, the majority of the game, they had time to do that. When we dumped properly and pursued and put pressure on them, they coughed the puck up, had some opportunities, got into a cycle. We did have some cycles and some sustained pressure in there, but not as much as we need to against that team or whatever. But you know what? Keeping the number one team that scores at will, per se, to, you know, three goals and a game is pretty good. So one, we did defend fairly well over the weekend. Both goaltenders were great. You know, Retzi on Saturday night and Macker on Friday night were stellar. So you know, I know Retzi, I don't know, Alex, was it hot in there? Was it hot in the building?
A lot of guys felt that it was hot in the building.
Yeah, I mean, and it was hot outside too on Saturday. And, you know, with the ice conditions and, you know, I was in the building pretty much all day. And we were, I told them, I think it was 61 degrees in there, which is kind of cool. But knowing that on Saturday night we're going to have a pretty big crowd.
About 3,800.
I'm like, you need to, I told them you need to drop the temp down in the building because it's going to get hot in there. And with that building being so big, if they don't do it quick enough, it can't catch up. And right. Obviously they didn't. But, you know, Retzi was cramping. I called a timeout because he was cramping. And told Mac, I looked down at the bench and I go, Mac, go get ready just in case. And he looks at me like, I got two heads on my shoulders, and he's like, I'm not going in there. I mean, type thing. I'm like, dude, he can't play. You might have to, man, type thing. So, but Retzi worked it out and this and that. So, again, it was good to see.
Yeah, I remember seeing that he did tough it out, and that was a gutty effort. Unfortunately, was not rewarded with any kind of result. Again, 3-1, Watertown 1 on Saturday. Before we get into Sunday and before we get into the break, there was a whole lot more that went into Saturday as well. That was our Legends Night as part of Whiteout Weekend. Jerome, you got to skate with a lot of your former teammates and guys that you had coached as well.
Just a couple teammates, more of my guys that I coached.
I was trying to give you a mix.
Well,
there.
I was definitely the best one that I played with. I know that. No, you know what? It was a special night. I mean, tell the guys that are in the locker room now that, I mean, that's what you play for. I don't miss the game. I miss those guys. You go in that locker room and you hear the same crappy jokes and the same hacks that you, you know, and Dougie Mann's an easy guy to pick on. But it was good to see those guys. And I know a couple of the guys that played for me with the Cottmos. Most of those guys were the 11-12 championship team. I think there was 8 of them or 9 of them here. And, you know, some of their posts on Facebook is just, it just gets you in your heart because some of those guys that were here for 4, 5, 6 years and that's a big part of their lives. And that friendship and that camaraderie mean so much to them, and it's always good to see them back in
the And we got meeting. The yearly tradition of Boom Boom dropping the gloves still.
Yeah, I'm still a little sore. My shoulder blades, my muscles back there, my traps are really sore kind of thing. I am getting too old for it, but
it was a lot of fun. You can catch the replay on our YouTube channel, Columbus River Dragons on YouTube. You can also catch replays of the John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show in podcast form on YouTube.
Gotta give a shout out to Fort Benning. The Fort Benning team. I wasn't expecting it to be that close to game, to be honest with you. It was 4-1. I mean,
4-2.
Oh yeah, yeah. Sorry.
Yeah.
It shouldn't have been a penalty shot. Come on.
Yeah, they called an instigator.
I told them to give it to him. And, they gave it to actually TJ Runcy, which he was filling in for Fort Benning.
Mm-hmm.
He's a pretty good little junior player that is a local guy here. So, but all in all, it was pretty good. I mean, Fort Benning had a kind of a game plan. As far as defensively, I mean, I don't think a whole lot of them know what to do with it in the offensive zone. Shout out to Matt DePoit, shooter. Shooter got his goal, and he's one of the long tooth guys on that team. Long time soldier, and he's helped out with the Snakes for years, so it was good to see him get a goal.
What were the rules that were kind of like preset? Because we know
there really was none.
Yeah, because there were some people were rolling guys off of glass, people were throwing elbows and stuff in the corner. And I'm like, this ain't a Legends game. This
supposed
is
supposed to be not hit. It's supposed to be kind of USA hog or
non-check.
Non-check. But I told the guys who were ref, and I'm like, hey. It's men's league with a little bit of give. I know. John Sullivan, number 21 for the Snakes, he's the most angry American I know. And he hacks and whacks, and he's nasty to play against, and he clam-basted somebody in the corner. I'm like, there's Sully. Yeah, he's very happy. It's a friendly game out there, and he just runs a guy. Anyways, it was good. And you know what? I mean, at the same time, too. Like, I mean, yes, it's supposed to be no hit, but at the same time, hey, there's 1,500 people in the building, too. They want to see.
Yeah, it was well attended. It was a lot of fun, a great experience. And again, that replay is on YouTube if anybody wants to watch back and see the Legends go at it against the Fort Benning Hockey Club. Let's take a break. When we come back, we'll conclude the weekend with a look at Sunday's win. Alex Storjohann was burying a goal in that one as well. Get his thoughts on that and wrap up the weekend after this. John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show, Columbus River Dragons Radio Network.
The Chattahoochee's favorite place for spirits in the valley is John Emerald Distilling Company in Opelika. Conveniently located in beautiful downtown Opelika, they're open Monday through Saturday for tours, tasting, and bottle sales. Not in Opelika? No problem. From Birmingham to Columbus, there's plenty of places where John Emerald originals are sold. Check out some of their favorite recipes at johnemeralddistilling.com and give them a follow on social media at JED Spirits on Twitter and Instagram.
An injury can be a game changer. That's why Houston Sports Medicine Team provides urgent ortho care, Saturday morning injury clinics during hockey season, and an emergency room at Jack Houston Memorial Hospital. An injury can be a game changer, and immediate evaluation and care can be a game changer too. For more information, go to Houston.com or call 706-324-6661.
Dressing for success is as easy as 1, 2, 3 with Wade Cleaners. Drop off your garment at any one of their 5 convenient branches or call their valet manager to pick them up. Go do something fun. Walk your dog, eat a hot fudge sundae, or go to a movie. Leave the dirty laundry to them. Pick up your professionally cleaned garments or have them delivered at no additional charge to your home or office. Yes, you too can dress for success with Wade Cleaners. Oh, and don't forget the little people as you move up in the world.
Looking to update that hockey game day wardrobe? The best place to do that is to visit the online home for all River Dragons licensed apparel, ourdragonsmerch.com. With new designs coming out all the time and special promotional and sale offers always live, there's always a reason to check back to the site and score some new gear. Plus, lots of fun souvenirs and other knickknacks that make great gifts for all sorts of occasions. So get there to ourdragonsmerch.com, the official store for all team licensed apparel. That's ourdragonsmerch.com.
Welcome back to the John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show here on the Columbus River Dragons Radio Network, coming to you live from the studios in PMB Broadcasting in Columbus. John Emerald Distilling's headquarters out in Opelika, Alabama. Live tours and tastings every day that they're open. And if you can't make it out to Opelika, check out a few of our favorites here in Columbus. Serve the John Emerald line of products, Nonick Beer Bar and Kitchen downtown, Jarfly on 13th Street, as well as the Bottle Shop on Broadway. And of course, John Emerald is served at the Columbus Civic Center. You're looking to come out to some games. We got one coming up tomorrow, Wednesday, 7:30 puck drop against Carolina. It's the last single game, and then we got one more home weekend, April 9th and 10th, before we get to the playoffs. Season's really winding down here, Jerome.
Yeah, those Thunder Chickens are coming into town. Is that what those guys call them?
That's what some people call them, okay. Yes. That's what I have heard. John Emerald Distilling, proud partner of Ignite Sports and Entertainment. Before we move on to Sunday's game, Jerome, you and I talked about it, and we were remiss if we forgot about what happened in the pregame on Saturday. Obviously, the Legends game was great. There was a little ceremony that led in to the game against the Watertown Wolves. The banner, new banner going up in the Columbus Civic Center. The Amos family name, of course, Wanda and Shelby, who we know mean so much to you and the rest of the Cottonmouths family. Great ceremony for them. How was that? It seemed like a lot of fun down there at ice level.
Yeah, no, it was awesome. I mean, I know for the players, I kind of, you know, kind of broached them like, guys, it's going to be a little bit longer. It's kind of tough to stand there and try to keep zoned in for the game, but you know, Juan and Shelby have given so much to the community and so much to keep hockey in town for as long as they did, and for us to be able to pull that off. And it was a incognito kind of type thing, because Jeff came up, Jeff really wanted to do this, and you know, Jeff had called Wanda and basically said, hey, I'm going to give, or Jerome's going to get something, an award, and we're going to recognize him for this and that and whatever. So she was under impression this was all going to be about me. And so when we turned it around on her type thing, but so, you know, national anthem's going, this and that, and Shelby was up in the suites, and the song's going, national anthem singing, and I'm looking up there, and he's not up there. I'm like, grab my phone. I'm like, well, I can't call. The national anthem's playing right now. That's pretty inappropriate. So I'm like, hold on a sec or whatever. So I'll just wait. And then as soon as it comes off, or as soon as it goes off, I call up to the suite to Andrew Burnett, and I'm like, Andrew, get Shelby out on out on the deck right now in the balcony. Like, I mean, Juan is getting, we're doing something for Wanda type thing. So yeah, so long story short, she was so shocked and pretty emotional, and she was pretty blown away. So it was pretty cool. And then when I told the boys to come out on the ice, I was talking about the Legends hockey guys, and all the River Dragons came out too, which actually I didn't plan that. I think Petro said, let's go or whatever, but Wanda was so touched, and she's like, I mean, she was in tears, I was in tears, everybody was crying. And yeah, then I talked to Wanda afterwards, and she's like, all Shelby said was, It should be Shelby and Wanda Amos, not Wanda and Shelby Amos. And he's like, and it was kind of funny because everyone was trying to get him out in the balcony, and he's like, I've seen, they call me Precious. I'm Precious number one. Oh. And they're like, we've all seen Precious get plenty of awards. That's the last thing I want to see is Precious get another award or this and that. I'm like, geez, this is for you guys. Come on. So, type thing. So anyways, it was great. On that note,
I kind of wondered because, you know, you see your number 16 up there and the, you know, the Snakes banner and all that. I would have thought that wouldn't have drawn more suspicion. Like, Jerome already has a banner though. Like, I would have thought more people wouldn't have asked questions about that.
I don't know. Anyways, it was good. She was blown away. So, it was a great start to that Saturday night game.
It was very good. And we already talked about the Saturday game, but we do have to talk about the Sunday game. River Dragons playing. Obviously, the weekend had been won, but playing for some crucial and key points. At that point, we knew we couldn't catch Danbury for second heading into the weekend, but a midweek game could help us there. But still, important to put on a good effort and, you know, not completely get swept, even in the season series too, because when you think about it, over the five games we hadn't taken a point from Watertown to that point. We get up there and it's 1-0 Watertown after 40 minutes. Ahmad Mahfouz's goal, 1:28 in, is the only tally to speak of. And then in the third period, River Dragons come out with two goals, Storjohann and White again. So before we get into the goals, what was said between the second and third period? Something had to light a fire.
No, not really. I mean, we were playing well. I mean, it was a good hockey game, back and forth, and they're having opportunities. We had some good chances. Their goalie made some big saves, and Macker made a couple big saves too, kind of thing. So, like, basically it was, guys, we're in a playoff hockey game, and let's go. We got to learn how to play this style, and, you know, we're going to have to win some games coming down the stretch, 2-1 and 3-2, and you know, I can't even remember your goal, Alex. What kind of
before we even got to,
you thought it was 1-1 after we scored the second.
Well,
one.
No, yeah. Well, hey, I'm still so tired. I was so tired. I mean, you know, and well, the cat's out of the bag now. You know, they pulled the goalie with a minute and a half or something. Yep. I'm like, what the hell are they doing pulling the goalie for? I mean, it's a 1-1 game. I guess they really want to win this game and get going.
Yeah, and then that bus is fueled up and ready
and
to go.
And then I look up, I'm like, oh, we're winning. I forgot about Whitey's goal.
Oh, my goodness.
Well, and I was, like, the weekend myself, like, between three games and three nights, the Legends game, showed like three or four properties in the morning, and I'm like, I got no sleep whatsoever, and then trying to get prepared and what I'm like, I was just,
everything's a blur.
Sunday was rough. You know, so
all right, well, let's start.
And it's easier to play than it is to coach. It really is, because you have no, you're tired more emotionally as a coach, and you know, you got to be sharp, and you guys are tired physically, and I'm trying to stay as positive and kind of energized to give you guys energy kind of thing or whatever. But anyways,
well, let's corroborate some stories here. Alex, what was that locker room in between the second and third period heading that Sunday game?
Like Boom said, I mean, we were confident. We knew we were kind of outplaying them, and you know, I kind of had a feeling it was going to come. We just kept working. And
yeah, that second period, 20-13 was the shots on goal. So Columbus was averaging a shot a minute. You could definitely feel the pressure. And then 8:01 into the third, second pro goal, third game, but second in as many nights. Pretty good to get another one quick, right?
Yeah, same kind of thing. Forecheck, it came up the wall. Schulte made a good play, and we caught him in transition, kind of out of position, and got it in the spot that I like to have it, and luckily it went in again.
Very nice. 1-1 at that point, and then...
And I like to say I really like that spot that he shoots for, too, unlike the rest of my guys. Everybody wants to go crossbar down and this and that, and I'm like, that's not where you score, guys. It's not where you score. It's got to be in tight inside on the post, just a foot and a half off the ice. And if you hit the post, probably going to get in or inside the post, but if you miss it, it's probably underneath his arm or in his elbow. And I mean, yeah
was a good
goal. We got a lot in common.
Yeah, no, I usually do shoot there, but that one did go by right by his ear. But
You probably missed it, man.
Well, you're thinking on the same wavelength, at least in some ways. 1-1, and then Ian White's goal, 2-1. That ended up being the final. 10-14 into the third. White gets his sixth goal of the year. Parker Moskal and Storjohann pick up the assists. Alex, what'd you see? How did that play develop? Because you were right there on the ice. You were actually pretty well involved in it. Probably the best angle of anyone to see it go in.
Again, it was just, this was a little bit deeper transition, and our neutral zone came up. Parker, I kind of put it in his feet, and he received it well, came around, and, I mean, he did the rest. He made a great play, and Whitey finished it. So
huge goal gives River Dragons all 3 points for that one. Only 3 points out of 9 on the weekend, but good crowds, new banner in the arena, legends come back in, so everyone's got good feeling. I mean, overall, yeah, you're unhappy with the record, but still, the weekend as a whole in Columbus, you could really feel that hockey energy alive.
Yeah, no, for sure. And you know, just team-wise, I thought, I think we learned as a team. We played through some things, and you know what? Hard work and determination will take you a long way, and that's one thing that we did. We did work hard. First two games, we didn't work very smart type thing, but I really thought we learned and we grew as a hockey team.
2-1 the final in that one. Bailey McBurney had the win on a 35 save night out of 36 shots. Let's take a break. When we come back, we interview our special player guest for tonight's episode, Alex Storjohann. Learned where he came from, how he became a River Dragon. Start to pick his brain a little more about his first weekend with the team. After this, on the Columbus River Dragons Radio Network.
At Southern States Bank, the Common Sense Bank, we're a true community bank that supports the places we serve. Our people live, work, and play in your community. And you will find us cheering for the River Dragons right alongside you in the stands. With convenient locations throughout Alabama and Georgia, we're never too far away to handle any of your financial concerns. Call, click, or come by and see how we can help you make sense out of your banking. Visit us online at southernstatesbank.net. Southern States Bank, member FDIC. Equal housing lender. NMLS number 410611.
When it comes to working on the land, springtime is go time. From mowing and mulching to planting and hauling, be ready to tackle any job with quality John Deere equipment from SunSouth. We'll help you find the right equipment to meet your needs. And right now, you can get 0% financing for 72 months on select John Deere 1 through 5 series tractors. So why wait another season to do more and save more? For quality John Deere equipment, come see us at SunSouth. Equipment for those that do.
Some restrictions apply. See expires March 31st, 2022.
Shred all your document shredding needs. With custom purchase equipment, no maintenance expenses, no need to prepare records for destruction, increased employee productivity, increased security, no worry. Was it really destroyed? Right now, all new customers can receive 10% off. Shredaway, a division of the Overby Company, locally owned and operated in downtown Columbus. That's Shredaway, 706-577-9668.
It's River Dragon season, and it's time to get out to a game. Visit Ticketmaster or the Civic Center box office to purchase tickets to the next game or any game left this season. Visit rdragons.com to check the schedule and stay up to date with everything River Dragons hockey. The defending Ignite Cup champions are looking to keep their winning ways, and you can be part of the best atmosphere in the FPHL to help make it happen. Purchase tickets online on Ticketmaster or skip the fees and visit the Columbus Civic Center box office during normal business hours. Get up and get loud, Columbus. The River Dragons are ready to roar.
Welcome back in to the John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show. It's a Tuesday night, March 22nd, game day eve. We got a game coming up against Carolina Thunderbirds tomorrow night, 7:30 puck drop at the Civic Center. Tickets available, Civic Center box office or on Ticketmaster, 7 o'clock, Fort Benning, Harley-Davidson. Pre-game show will be live with you on the network for that one. For yeah, that,
who,
though.
Who plays on Wednesdays? Do we not know that we're in the Bible Belt?
Well, I don't know. We play on Sundays, too, so that's another
well,
big.
Well, Sunday's a little different. Wednesday night, there's always church on Wednesday nights, guys.
What is there a preferred weekday then that it's gotta be on?
Tuesday, Thursday?
Okay.
Just FYI.
Man, good to know. Good to know for later. We've got Jerome Bichard in studio, as you just heard, and Alex Storjohann is our our special player guest for today's episode. And Alex, coming from Anthem, Arizona, and of course people think Arizona, they don't think hockey market, but recently it has absolutely become it. Obviously, you got guys like Austin Matthews out there. I think the NHL's emphasis on, you know, putting the Coyotes there and trying to establish that as a market. You lived it, you grew up it. Tell us how Arizona's become a hockey market to produce players like yourself.
Yeah, so I was actually born in Alaska and lived there till I was 10, and then
well, Elite Prospects doesn't say that.
I'm proud of the Arizona part. So when I moved there, it wasn't where it is now. You know, like the 93s, my older brother, a lot of his buddies went D1. There's some good players coming out, but yeah, came down to like a lot of the pro guys stuck around after their career because they liked it in the Valley, and then they started coaching and brought up that Junior Coyotes program, and now we're seeing all the players who got to take in all that knowledge and stuff.
So. Well, now I want to ask about Alaska, because obviously there's plenty of hockey up there, but it's so isolated. That's got to be a unique setup, right?
Yeah, actually Phoenix has a bigger hockey market than Alaska because there's not that many people up there, right? But yeah, growing up playing on the ponds and stuff, and then going to Arizona and playing outside on the pavement, playing roller hockey. So
big city in Alaska, or kind of like remote area, like Anchorage, Juneau? Okay,
yeah,
Anchorage.
Yeah, from Anchorage. So
okay, there you go. So moving Alaska to Arizona, and you said you were what, 10?
Yeah,
10 years old, right? Okay, so obviously that's a huge shift, you know, in terms of trying to play hockey. Probably a huge shift in climate too, and then you keep with it. I mean, was it difficult to keep up with it because
of high heat in Arizona? It's
right,
dry.
Right.
No, I'm meaning is it difficult to keep up with
come
it?
Come visit
of
me in July.
No, tell me that. 117 is 117, no matter what.
See July down here too. It gets rough. But I mean, in terms of the availability of hockey, keeping up with it, because I'm sure, you know, 10, 11 year old kid, you might have some other sports, you know, that you're playing as well. I mean, hockey, you really got to be dedicated and committed to it to keep up with it as Arizona is becoming more of a hockey styled market.
Yeah, so the closest rink to Anthem was about 30 minutes. So there's two rinks, each of them are 30 minutes away. There was a couple more, but so my brother practiced at one and I practiced at the other. And before he got his license, my parents also worked 30 minutes away. So they had to rush home from work, pick us up, take us two separate ways. And we didn't have time for anything else really at that point.
Your Elite Prospects list, 2014-15, you were the captain of your AA 18U team, the Arizona Hockey Union. No stats, so I don't got anything to go off of. You got anything from that before we move on to what I do know from my computer screen here?
No, I did have good numbers, and that's kind of where I got scouted to go play in Richmond. So
yeah, so Richmond Generals, 2015-16. People, fans of the River Dragons, will know that place. Jay Krupp, among other Richmond General alumni there. So you're getting out of really the whole west coast of it, either Alaska or Arizona, where you had two different places you had called home, and you're all the way smack dab across the country over in Virginia as what, 19, 20 year old?
18, 19, yeah.
18, 19 year old. So that process, what's that like? Because that's got to be interesting for you.
Yeah, so I was going to go play the year before that, but I wanted to stick around and finish high school with all my buddies and stuff, stay with my family. But going into Richmond, I mean, it was cool. I was ready to, you know, go see what junior hockey was about. My brother went off a couple years before me, and, you know, I've been looking up to those guys and hearing about it. And RC, the coach there, gave me a good opportunity to go in and play, and I actually had one of my best friends from the Arizona Hockey Union go with me. So
no nerves, just moving across country, just...
Yeah, I mean, I was ready.
Steely-eyed 18-year-old, you're ready.
I was ready to go, yeah.
I like it. So from Richmond one year, where you actually led the team in points and had a playoff berth that year. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were nothing. Okay. You looked at me. I thought you were going to say something to me. I know you will. I know you will. I was like, are you going to add on to a point? Am I going to say something wrong? Is Elite Prospects lying to me again? You know something I don't? So from that year, again, led the Richmond Generals in points that year. And then just to fully show off how traveled you are, you head up to Canada, 2016-17 with Carlton Place and Kirkland Lake. How'd you go from Richmond all the way up into Canada to continue your junior career?
So the coach, RC, in Richmond was good buddies with the Carlton Place coach. So I was looking at going to college after that first year. I had some D3 offers, but when Carlton Place called, I got some advice that I should probably go up there and see if I could, you know, get a scholarship or, you know, improve my game at least.
And you played 12 games with Carlton Place and then did a ton of damage in Kirkland Lake. Actually, you led the NOJHL that year in assists, 20 goals, 53 assists for a 73-point year. Obviously, big year for you, and then it rolls into moving to SUNY Cortland. I imagine having numbers like that probably got you on the recruiter's eyes, right?
I didn't get recruited by them, but I have a good friend from home who, his good buddy was the assistant coach there.
Okay.
And he went to SUNY Morrisville, so he was talking to me. He's like, you should probably go here, so...
So just kind of like a setup thing, you just went along with it, not too much shopping around in the D3 or ACHA ranks?
I talked to a few D3 teams, but talks just kind of fizzed out, and I was kind of in a weird place. I honestly committed pretty late. I was just sitting at home, and I was like, the head coach called me, and I was like, sure, didn't visit anything, knew I'd come into a cool spot. My brother went to Oswego, which is about an hour up the road, so we were familiar, and...
Well, there you go. And then spent 5 years there, but of course the 2020-2021 season not played due to the pandemic, so got that extra year, utilized it obviously. And I have to wonder this, how good did it feel to be able to say you're with SUNY Cortland, you know, 4 years, you're going to school and you're stable there, when you compare it to your last 3-4 years prior to that, from Arizona to Virginia all the way up in Canada? I mean, you were traveling a lot as a teenager into 21-year-old, now going out of place, that probably had to feel like it really helped solidify you, right?
Yeah, I mean, the whole college experience is about coming in with your class and then you know, having guys that you spend a couple years with that you really grow close to, and the community there. So that was definitely nice to be a part of.
Any radio friendly appropriate stories?
Where is Cortland?
It's about 40 minutes south of Syracuse, so it's dead central in New York.
Okay.
Upstate.
So how close to Binghamton? Because we're going to be heading up there in a couple of weeks.
It's about 40 minutes from Binghamton too.
There we go. All right. Any stories from college we can disclose on the radio, let the fans know?
I mean, probably none radio friendly that I can think of off the top of my head, but it's a really fun school, I'll say that.
So. For sure. And now you're 3 games deep into your pro career. So before we even talk about your first weekend, obviously we kind of talked about, you knew Jay Krupp from the Richmond Generals, but was that the connection? How did you get to Columbus? Because that's more travel, New York to Georgia now.
Yeah, so that is the connection. Jay had been talking to me the last couple of years, you know, when I was finished up, if I, you know, I should think about coming here. And I was waiting around after the season, about a week and a half, and I said, you know what, I'm done sitting here. So I called him. I said, let's go.
So what was it like first weekend? You're rolling in. Obviously, the team is in the playoffs, but in a heck of a race, you know, for the different seeds. Obviously, first round bye is on the line. So you walk in, and it's immediately like, hey, it's an intense environment, all these games right away.
Yeah, so I was coming off of some pretty intense games at school, too, because we just made the playoffs for the first time in 20 years. So,
there you go.
And I mean, every game in the Suniac is an absolute battle. You only get 16 of them. So college kind of prepared me for that, and I knew coming here I didn't want to think too much into what the game was. I just wanted to be the best version of myself and hopefully blend it in, and it's been going decent. So.
How are your expectations in terms of the first weekend? So obviously scoring 2 goals, had to feel pretty good. I mean, where did you want to be first weekend in a pro hockey versus where you are now? Pretty good?
Yeah, I just wanted to fit in and show the boys that I'm here, and I'm, you know, I want to give it my all and do everything I can to help us win. So that was just my focus, just work as hard as I can, and hopefully my skill can show up and I can get on the board, and that's what happens. So.
Well, there you go. Definitely the fans have taken to you, scoring twice at home. Whiteout weekend, it was a huge one. Jerome?
Yeah, you know what? I mean, just, I mean, time of year, are we lacking players? Are we lacking anybody? If anything, little goal scoring or secondary score, goal scoring, which, you know, throughout the year, it's been not a struggle, but Jagger Williamson's kind of been banged up all year and this and that. And then, you know, before you know it, I got three new forwards. I got a whole new different line, and you know, just as far as my mentality is like, my job is to get these guys to play the way we need to play, and I'm loyal. I want my guys who've been here all year to you know, get the opportunity, but then at the same time they've had the opportunity, type thing. So try to mix and match, and knowing that you've been off, Alex been off for a week and a half, 2 weeks, playing college pro, a little different, style, but you know, so, and then again, throw in the fact that, you know, I want to give them the opportunity that they need to show me what they can do. And that doesn't happen by being a 10th forward and this and that either, type thing. So, you know, got a tough job, Jack.
Yeah.
Got a tough job.
It is. No one said it was easy.
But you know what? I mean, going into it, just, you know, kind of try to set expectations for everybody in that locker room. Guys have been here all year. Guys are new and this and that. And, you know, so just try to be as honest as you possibly can. Can't be totally honest with sometimes what your thought process is, but I pretty much am. I think everybody, I'm kind of an open book.
One guy with a complicated last name to another. What was the craziest butchering you've had in your first pro weekend? Doesn't have to come from Jerome. Could have been from anybody in the room.
Oh, I mean, it was definitely Jerome. We'll get that out there. But my nickname's Storge, and I mean, I heard at least, Boom called me like six different things. George, Shroge, like just every like pronunciation you could possibly mess up.
I got to come up with something mouth, better than that.
I knew he was talking to me though.
All right, well, we got it now. Alex Storjohann, good to learn about you. Good to meet you, and I can't wait to see what you got for the rest of this season. Should be a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Let's take another break. When we come back, we conclude tonight's John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show with a look ahead to a midweek game and then a road trip up to Harrington, Delaware, our last games with the Delaware Thunder. That comes up after this on the Columbus River Dragons Radio Network.
The Chattahoochee's favorite place for spirits in the valley is John Emerald Distilling Company in Opelika. Conveniently located in beautiful downtown Opelika, they're open Monday through Saturday for tours, tasting, and bottle sales. Not in Opelika? No problem. From Birmingham to Columbus, there's plenty of places where John Emerald originals are sold. Check out some of their favorite recipes at johnemeralddistilling.com and give them a follow on social media at JED Spirits on Twitter and Instagram.
Dressing for success is as easy as 1, 2, 3 with Wade Cleaners. Drop off your garment at any one of their 5 convenient branches or call their valet manager to pick them up. Go do something fun. Walk your dog, eat a hot fudge sundae, or go to a movie. Leave the dirty laundry to them. Pick up your professionally cleaned garments or have them delivered at no additional charge to your home or office. Yes, you too can dress for success with Wade Cleaners. Oh, and don't forget the little people as you move up in the world.
At Southern States Bank, the Common Sense Bank, we're a true community bank that supports the places we serve. Our people live, work, and play in your community. And you will find us cheering for the River Dragons right alongside you in the stands. With convenient locations throughout Alabama and Georgia, we're never too far away to handle any of your financial concerns. Call, click, or come by and see how we can help you make sense out of your banking. Visit us online at southernstatesbank.net. Southern States Bank. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender, NMLS number 410611.
Progress. It's the belief that your life should be easier, that life should be fun, and that the best is yet to come. With us, you have a provider who pours everything into bringing progress home. And it's not just some big name in a faraway glass tower. That provider is here. That provider is Beam. With local service and faster internet, the only place you're going is forward, and we're taking you there. Progress, your Beam, your way.
Looking to bring the whole crew out to a game? Group nights are for you. Groups of 10 or more get special ticket pricing and exclusive merchandise and experience add-ons that will make your game at the Civic Center a night to remember. For more information on group rates and packages, visit rdragons.com/tickets or call our ticketing manager at 706-940-0476. Ask about all the great perks we can provide your group. Work friends, family functions, there's no group too big for us to handle. But it starts by visiting rdragons.com/tickets.
You should see me in a crowd. I'm gonna run, there's nothing to hide. Watch me make them bow. Wanna buy
Welcome back in. John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show here on a Tuesday night. Got about 10 or so minutes left in today's show. I'm Zach DeBozart. We just learned about our special player guest, Alex Storjohann, today in studio with us. And of course, Jerome Bichard is with us as well. It's time to look ahead at the upcoming weekend, or in this case, week of games. A rare midweek home game coming up here tomorrow, Wednesday night. Carolina Thunderbirds in town. This is not the last time we'll see the Carolina Thunderbirds. Will actually close out the home part of our schedule against them in mid-April, but big game, especially coming off of a win on Sunday, and got to feel like, yeah, there's some momentum you can roll in, but it's a quick turnaround, even though we're still at home here, Jerome.
Yeah, you know what, 3-3, Sunday or Monday off, quick little skate today, and then pregame skate tomorrow. Yeah, I'd rather have that than have the whole week off and then and then get back. So, you know, didn't have a hard skate today, but I think we got some stuff accomplished. And you know what, Winston-Salem, hey, they got a good little hockey team. They play hard. They play the right way. And you know, I mean, I think we match up well against them. And I think we're a little bit more talented, and I think we got a little bit more heart on our hockey team than they do, so that should all be good.
It's going to be a fun one. Tickets available Civic Center box office or on Ticketmaster. A 7:30 puck drop means a 7 o'clock Fort Benning Harley-Davidson pregame show here on the network. Then we head up to Harrington, Delaware for our final games of the season with the Delaware Thunder. Saturday, Sunday, we actually won't play Friday. We're going to be the team off while Delaware is at Danbury, and then they come back home where we will meet them at the Thunderdome, play two games there. Interesting setup. Obviously, Delaware, a team that might be eliminated from the playoffs right now, but they just beat Binghamton last Sunday. They're still a team playing for pride, and they're a very dangerous team at times.
Well, you know what? What have we played them? Five games?
I think four or five. Yeah, I think that's where we're at.
You know, the two games up there, I think they were here for three.
Yeah, five.
You know, I think they played better on the road than they did at home, to be honest with you. But no, they're a tough team to play against. They, you know, a team that doesn't have a spot to play for or whatever is kind of dangerous, because they play carelessly and they don't care. They just want to score goals, and if we don't play the right way, you kind of buy into that. And the games that they played here in Columbus, they were all pretty good games. There wasn't a game that I thought we were going to lose, but at the same time, they were all fairly close. They weren't blowouts or this and that, and they play fairly well defensively. They play in a box. Their D don't veer out very far. There's not a whole lot of shooting room. They block shots. They do that. So we got to be on our toes, and can't let anything slip away from us.
That's Saturday and Sunday live from the Thunderdome. Saturday is a 7 o'clock puck drop. Sunday is a 3 o'clock puck drop. Because of network and other physical limitations, we will not be able to bring you the games on YouTube live. We will have the radio network coverage out there, though. So 6:30 and 2:30 are the pregame shows Saturday and Sunday. And then we will do premiere replays on YouTube during the week, so you can get everything caught up and have the games in full archive. For the rest of the league, there is another game during the midweek on Wednesday, and it's important for us, Jerome. Danbury at Watertown, 7:30 puck drop, the two teams ahead of us. And what's interesting is because we're so close in the standings, Danbury at 6:07, Columbus at 6:06, it's a rare circumstance where Columbus can get all 3 points and not have to worry about what Danbury does, because we'll pass them by the points percentage. It's so close, the math works out weird, but Columbus wins, takes all 3 points against Carolina. They will be second place heading into that weekend.
Wow.
Yeah, that's about the reaction I expected.
Hey, we just got to worry. I don't care what they do. We just got to worry about us. And, you know, we'll be where we are. And you know what? We can make it easier on ourselves, or we can make it harder on ourselves. Either way. Second place is important. It really is, because, like I said, you can make it really hard on ourselves, or we can make it a little easier on ourselves.
So Danbury at Watertown and Carolina at Columbus on Wednesday. Friday's action, already mentioned, Delaware at Danbury, Watertown at Port Huron, Binghamton at Carolina. That Binghamton and Carolina series extends all the way into Sunday. Then Watertown and Port Huron flip locations, head to Port Huron while we head up to Delaware. Storage, you ready for the first road trip for you of the year?
Yeah, we're going up to Delaware. I mean, I just made a long trip to get down here, and then we're coming back, and then we're going up to Binghamton, where I just came from. So, but I'm excited.
Well, as we detailed, you're quite an accomplished and experienced traveler, so I'll expect you to be ready for it.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of pavement.
You get to ride on the River Dragon bus. Beautiful. We haven't named her yet. We got to give her a name.
I'm surprised we haven't yet. It's been 3 years.
I don't know. I'm going to have to work on that.
All right. We'll figure that out at some point. I'm sure that'll be a topic of discussion on the bus.
Have a professional driver instead of Boomer driving.
It'll be fun. Columbus hosting Carolina on Wednesday, and then at Delaware on Saturday and Sunday. What else going on this weekend, Jerome? We got a Friday, but I mean, we're probably traveling that Friday, right?
Yeah, we'll leave Friday night. Not much. I'm busy. Got some things on the go.
There we go.
Got a couple closings, one tomorrow, and then a couple showings and this and that. So I don't get a day off. I never get a day off.
Seems like nobody does. Alex, anybody to shout out back at home? Obviously, good to get to know you here. One of the new guys in the room.
Yeah, I mean, I'll give a shout out to my girlfriend Annie up in Cortland, and then my mom, all my family back home.
All right, we like it. I guess we're going to wrap it up there. The John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show for tonight ends this Wednesday night. Carolina Thunderbirds are in town against the Columbus River Dragons. 7:30 puck drop means a 7 o'clock Fort Benning Harley-Davidson pregame show. And then later on in the weekend, Saturday and Sunday, up in the Thunderdome, taking on the Delaware Thunder. 7 o'clock Saturday, 3 o'clock Sunday. No YouTube for Saturday and Sunday. We will have the full network coverage, YouTube, radio, and the like on Wednesday. But we will premiere those games for you during the midweek after we get done from Delaware.
But you could watch Delaware's YouTube?
You could watch Delaware's YouTube.
And turn you on?
Yeah. Some people have been able to sync it up, and it's difficult to do because like YouTube allows you to do, a player. You can like scroll it back. Like, oh, I'm like 10, 20, whatever seconds behind. But I think a lot of people, the problem is, the radio stays so far ahead of it, you can't jump it into the future. So they try, and sometimes it works. But I can't promise it.
I wouldn't be able to do that.
It's tricky, and it's just one of the unfortunate things about having to go to Delaware. But they got a nice staff up there. They're nice.
Sure, they do, Zach.
They're nice to me. I don't know if they're nice to you guys down there at ice level. They're nice to me in the treehouse. You see me up top there. If Jerome really wanted to get my attention, he could just throw a pen or something and probably nick me in the ear.
Yeah, it's crazy. No, it's all right. I'm just. Hopefully the weather's good up there and it's half decent and no rain, no snow, and we're good.
I'll take it up there because I know it won't be in Binghamton. I don't care if it'll be April. It'll still be real cold up there. I just get that feeling. Don't you?
I hope not.
You hope not, but come on. All right, that'll do it for tonight's edition of the Coaches Show. Again, Wednesday night, we are live at 7 o'clock on the Fort Benning Harley-Davidson pregame show, a 7:30 puck drop against Carolina, Saturday and Sunday against Delaware. For Alex Storjohann and Jerome Bichard, I'm Zach DeBozart. Have a good night, everybody. We'll see you tomorrow on the Columbus River Dragons Radio Network.
Listening to the John Emerald Distilling Coaches Show on the Columbus River Dragons Radio Network. Tonight's show was brought to you by John Emerald Distilling, Southern States Bank, BioLife Plasma, Midas Total Car Care, Vector Ply, and PMB Broadcasting. All rights to this broadcast are reserved for the private use of our audience. Any reproduction, retransmission, or other distribution of the descriptions or accounts of this show may not take place without the express written consent of Ignite Sports and Entertainment and PMB Broadcasting. This has been a presentation of the Columbus River Dragons Hockey Club.